Morning. Good morning. Welcome to South Heaven First United Methodist Church. We're coming to you live this morning from 723 Star Landing Road East. It's good to see everyone in the house of the Lord, and we're glad that those of you that are watching online this morning, we're glad you're with us for our worship service today also. I have chills every time I hear that song. Somebody behind me was humming it and kind of singing along this morning, and I was too. For those of you who've been members of this church for several years, you remember our very own Rosemary Beckett. And was it Gerald McCray she sang that with? With a former member who lives in the Birmingham area now named Gerald McCray. And they would sing a duet singing, "I've Just Seen Jesus." And boy, it was powerful. Rosemary has, she's been dead several years now. I don't remember exactly. For 4 or 5 years anyway, and what a beautiful voice she had, as did Gerald. Announcements this morning. First of all, we are extremely blessed to have Miss Krista Hawks and her husband Adam Hawks here this morning. Brother Adam's going to be bringing our message this morning, and I told him last time he was here, she gets first billing, so... He agreed wholeheartedly.
Oh, yes. Sounds about right.
But our Bible study continues this coming Wednesday night. Trying to finish up the book of Genesis. And I think this coming Wednesday night probably will be the conclusion of that. And again, Bible study then again on Thursday morning. Flowers today are on the altar in honor of Denise Tucker's birthday, and I think that was last week, wasn't it, Dan?
Monday.
It was last Monday, okay? So, but happy birthday a few days late, and glad to see the flowers up here in your honor, Denise. Birthday's coming up this week. Well, our own Angie Jackson has a birthday today. She is here. Be sure to wish her a happy birthday today. I'll let her tell you how many. Marsha Mills has a birthday tomorrow. Elaine Spencer has a birthday tomorrow. And coming up Tuesday, Jessica Graham has a birthday. And
Tuesday would have been Sharon's birthday too.
When?
Tuesday would have been Sharon's.
Tuesday would have been Sharon's birthday. I'll tell you how old Jessica Graham's going to be, and it just floored me when I realized this morning. She will be 24 years old, and that makes me feel really, really old this morning. Yeah, and I'm proud to be here, too.
Amen.
Proud to be here. I'm thankful every day for every day the good Lord gives me. Any other announcements this morning? All got an anniversary too. Yeah, Robert and Kayla Grove have an anniversary tomorrow. I don't know how many that will be, but they are both still out sick, and we hope that they are recovering and will be back with us soon. Any other announcements this morning? Our hymn this morning, opening hymn is "We'll Understand It Better By and By." It's number 525 in your hymnals. But it'll be on the screen behind me as we stand and sing verses 1, 3, and 4.
Understand it.
Everybody hear me?
Amen.
If y'all would, turn to page 885 in your hymnals or follow along the screen behind me as we together recite a modern affirmation of our faith. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith lets us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen. Bringing to him all of our woes and all of our joys. If y'all would, just keep in mind that our eternal Redeemer is here forever. And after we have signed, after we have prayed silently, I will voice our prayer. Gracious, loving, Heavenly Father, Lord of hosts and King of kings, we are gathered in this place of worship today for you, to praise you, to celebrate you, to pray to you, and to ask you to guide us through life's triumphs and trials and tribulations. We ask that you would take note of us, poor sinners all, redeemed only by our right belief in the salvation afforded to us through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Please, Heavenly Father, cast your eye upon us and guide us, and help us ensure that with full hearts we engage in rightful worship to you. Now together may we pray the prayer that Christ taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Thank you.
71. Okay.
We are given by you.
South Haven First sets up a hard act to follow after that choir. Wonderful job, everybody. Just beautiful. Y'all would, if you wouldn't mind, please stand as you are able. Our reading of the scriptures today, taken from the book of the prophet Isaiah, 5th chapter, verse 1 through 7. Hear the word of God. Let me sing now for my well-beloved a song of my beloved concerning his vineyard. My well-beloved had a vineyard on a fertile hill. He dug it all around, removed its stones, and planted it with the choicest vine. And he built a tower in the middle of it, and also hewed out a wine vat in it. Then he expected it to produce good grapes, but it only produced worthless ones. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done already in it? Why, when I expected it to produce good grapes, did it produce only worthless ones? So now, let me tell you what I'm going to do with my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it will be consumed. I will break down its wall, and it will become trampled ground. I will lay it waste. It will not be pruned or hoed, but briars and thorns will come up. I will also charge the clouds to rain no rain on it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah his delightful plant. Thus he looked for justice, but behold, bloodshed. For righteousness, but behold, a cry of distress. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Please be seated. A brief prayer before we begin, one I've become rather fond of, actually an old Anglican prayer. It may be familiar to some of y'all. Father, what we know not, teach us. What we have not, give us. And what we are not, make us. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Now, considering that we're currently in Northwest Mississippi, I think I already know the answer to this question, but I've got to ask it anyway. Does anyone here own or operate a vineyard? Anybody at all? Nobody. Really? Huh. So nobody here cultivates their own grapes expressly for the purpose of making fancy wine. Muscadines don't count, so don't say you got muscadines. So that's no good. No? Okay. Now, let me ask you this then. Who here gardens or farms? Nobody? Somebody ought to want it. You don't. Okay. Okay, so it doesn't have to be a big garden or a big farm. It could be anything from a few bushes or potted plants or a vegetable patch. Or even if you've got a big operation, that's fine too. But anything, any gardening, any farming at all. Okay. Now we got, all right, now we're rolling. I thought we might have a few more gardeners and farmers in Mississippi than vineyard owners and operators. Now, what are some of the important aspects of gardening and farming? Well, one thing, you need decent soil, right? Yeah. We need a certain amount of moisture that we can either count on from the rainfall or provide ourselves through watering. What about sunlight? Need sunlight. Definitely need a certain amount of sunlight depending on what you're growing. And then, of course, you need some seeds. Now, these are the four most basic and essential things that any gardener would need to get started, right? Now, most of us are taught this either by our family or in elementary science class. Or at least we used to be. I assume they still are. We can go a little bit deeper, though, can't we? Now, what about the pH balance in the soil? What about fertilizer? What about drainage? Erosion control? Macronutrients? Micronutrients? Pesticides? Herbicides? It turns out that gardening can be just as complicated and detailed as we want it to be. Gardeners and farmers and botanists can really do some amazing things if they've got enough time and money and manpower. And when they do have what they need, the results are obvious. Beautiful gardens, healthy, productive fields of crops. Farmers and gardeners that I personally know, they most of them take great pride in their work, and they should, because it's hard, unforgiving work. And even when you do everything right, a few poorly timed days of rain or days of no rain or any number of other little variables can ruin all that hard work. So now, if y'all will indulge me, I'd like to imagine the most beautiful garden you've ever seen. Now, maybe it was a botanical garden park, or maybe it was your grandmother's flower beds. Maybe it was a neighbor's vegetable garden. It doesn't really matter. Just picture it. Everybody got it? All right. Now I'd like you to imagine the worst garden you've ever seen. I'm talking about weeds, brambles, kudzu. Maybe they've got pecan trees growing up in it. Now, of all the really poor gardens that I've ever seen, the biggest common denominator I've noticed is neglect. All right? Y'all know the kind of gardens I'm talking about. The ones that maybe at one point were beautiful and maintained and well-tended, but for one reason or another, they've just been allowed to grow wild. The kind where it really would just look a lot better if they ripped everything up and started from scratch, or just placed some concrete and asphalt and call it a day. Now, rarely do we see a well-tended garden, one that is cultivated with love and attention and discipline, not do at least moderately well. Some years will be better than others, and there are exceptions, but most of the time a garden that's taken care of is going to at least look okay. Now, some years it may be beautiful and fruitful, but even in years of extreme drought and infestation, that well-tended garden, like I said, will most of the time do better than the gardens around it that are not as well-tended. It's rare to see such a garden do poorly, but occasionally it does happen. The prophet Isaiah was living in just such a metaphorical garden. At that time, it was the kingdom of Judah. So let's refresh our memories briefly. The prophet Isaiah lived around the time frame of 700 BC. He was born into a wealthy family in Jerusalem, which was in the kingdom of Judah at that point in time. Isaiah is one of the most influential prophets of the Old Testament, and it is of particular interest to us and many of our Christian brethren because he prophesied at great length about the coming of the Messiah, and Jesus Christ would come 700 years later and fulfill all of his prophecies and many others. Isaiah is, of course, very important to us, and he was important in his own time, but he was not particularly well-liked because of his familial connections to the upper crust of Jerusalem high society. Isaiah found himself particularly well-placed to communicate these prophecies that God was sending to him. Unfortunately for the rich and the powerful of Jerusalem, the news from Isaiah, from the Lord, was not good. So let's remember, this is the year 700 BC, 700 years before Jesus Christ was born or thereabouts. The kingdom of Judah and the kingdom of Israel had split into two separate political entities. The northern kingdom of Israel was much more prone to backslide into ungodly worship for years on end, and they rarely had a righteous king. The kingdom of Judah in the south, on the other hand, was seen as the true spiritual successor of the original combined kingdom of Israel from the time of King David and of King Solomon. Now, more was expected of Judah from the Heavenly Father. The sad fact of the matter, though, is that Judah also had problems for several years, generations, in fact. Judah would be plagued with a succession of increasingly ungodly kings and became, at times, just as wicked as the northern kingdom. This displeased our God greatly, and he would punish Judah through drought or foreign invasion. But usually a righteous king, such as King Hezekiah, would come forth and take the throne and attempt to correct the ills of his predecessors. And the ills were almost always centered around the breaking of God's covenant, tolerating, or in some cases encouraging, the worship of false gods, disobeying God's commandments, ignoring proper Levitical worship, and many other sins would often bring God's justice upon the kingdom of Judah. Now, Isaiah's job, which is not one that I would particularly envy, was to tell the people of Judah just how far they had fallen from the grace of God and just how he was preparing to deal with them. Now imagine poor Isaiah going to all the wealthy and influential people in Jerusalem and telling them that everything is about to get ugly and fast. Here's one problem that Isaiah had to contend with. Everyone, for the most part, put up with him and his prophesying for a long time. But the people of the kingdom of Judah were a proud group. They thought that they were special, which they were. But they refused to honor God for the favor that he had shown them. Here, Isaiah is in the mightiest city in the kingdom of Judah, which we remember was more favored than the other kingdom of God's chosen people. So the people of Jerusalem were already even more blessed than other Israelites. They're in the favorite country. They're in the favorite city of the favorite country. And they're members of God's favorite chosen people. These people who were so proud and so powerful were not particularly interested in hearing about how they were going to be punished by God, which, in their defense, is by no means unique to that group at that time. Nobody wants to hear that. Isaiah's challenge, and the challenge of all contemporary witnesses of Christ, was to convey this bad news of impending judgment in a way that these people would understand. So let's look back at our scriptural readings from chapter 5, about halfway through verse 1 and 2. My well-beloved has a vineyard on a fertile hill. He dug it all around, removed its stones, and planted it with choicest vines. And then he built a tower in the middle of it, and also hewed out a wine vat in it. Then he expected it to produce good grapes, but it produced only worthless ones. Now here is something that the wealthy and powerful of Jerusalem can understand. An agricultural parable. In 700 years before the time of Christ, people understood about agriculture. So let's think about it like they would have. All right? Imagine I found a terrific place for a vineyard. A nice hill to cut in some terraces for my vineyard, maybe. I just spent a tremendous amount of time and money and effort. I built a tower for the storage of the harvested grapes, and I built a wine vat so that I can process the fruit. I've put everything in place to ensure I have the best possible grapes for the sweetest and tastiest wine I can. And then what happens? Despite my best efforts, the grapes are worthless. Worthless can mean rotten, bitter, small, too hard, too soft, too big. But one thing is for sure, they are totally worthless for making wine, which is the only reason that I grew them in that first place. So anyone who may have been ignoring Isaiah up to this point may have started to pay attention right about now. What are you supposed to do when all your vines are putting on worthless grapes? So we turn to verse 3. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? Why, when I expected it to produce good grapes, did it produce worthless ones? So now let me tell you what I am going to do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it will be consumed. I will break down its wall, and it will become trampled ground. I will lay it waste. It will not be pruned or hoed, but briars and thorns will come up in it. Now, eventually, the time comes when you have to cut your losses. You spend all this time and money and effort on what is ultimately a futile endeavor. And no matter what you do, those grapes will always be worthless. Now, what do you do in that situation? You break it down and you start over from scratch somewhere else. Not because you want to. You don't want to. It breaks your heart. But you don't have a choice. To do otherwise would be to throw good money and time after bad. Now, I think the people of Jerusalem who heard or read what Isaiah was saying here probably started to get a little uncomfortable at this point. But for anyone who was either not paying attention or maybe weren't connecting the dots at this point in our scriptural reading, Isaiah hits them hard with verse 7. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah his delightful plant. Thus he looked for justice, but behold, bloodshed. For righteousness, but behold, a cry of distress. Now here he lays it out, plain as day. A message that not even the proud leaders of Judah in Jerusalem could ignore. And true to form, Judah was judged and condemned by God subsequently. Judah's punishment was the invasion of their lands and their subjugation by the Babylonians. And even though Isaiah told the Israelites that they would be preserved through this Babylonian captivity and eventually restored to the lands that God had promised them, it would be a long and painful period of punishment for God's chosen. For my gardeners and my farmers out there, in some instances, there is no amount of weeding or landscaping or fertilizing that can repair a garden or a piece of land. A time when the gardener must tear out every plant, when a farmer must apply a strong herbicide and disc up the ground and start over. Now, this isn't just true for those who cultivate. It's true in life. It's true of all of us. And how much truer is it of our perfectly just Almighty God. Now, most of us here, and those of us who are watching from home, probably already know that we are deserving of God's divine and perfect justice. We are in no better shape than the vineyard that Isaiah writes about. But our God loves us and extends an amount of love and forgiveness that only He could possibly provide. But even with that, are we deserving of His gift of love and mercy on our own? Of course not. What possible path is there for us to find worth in the eyes of God the Father? What can we do to find redemption in His eyes and keep ourselves from being harrowed out like a weedy garden? We can accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, loved ones. We can open our hearts to the way of the Redeemer, the Son of God, the source of our eternal salvation. It costs us nothing of heavenly value. All we must do is turn away from the empty pleasures of sin, which may taste sweet at first, but will turn to a bitter poison on our tongues and in our souls. If we do that, if we accept Jesus Christ, repent, and proclaim the good news of Christ risen to the world, we will not only be spared from the perfect justice of our Heavenly Father, but we will also be bathed forever in His eternal, perfect grace and mercy. Amen. In so doing, we transform from the weeds of an overgrown garden. Instead of worthless grapes from the vine, we find ourselves supremely useful in the eyes of the Lord. And our utility to Him will be defined by our willingness to do as He asks, whenever He asks, fulfilling our true purpose, celebrating God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit for all of eternity. Amen.
Amen.
Our closing hymn will be number 382. Have thine own way, Lord. And as you stand, if you will stand, if you can stand, and as you sing, if any feel led to come to these kneelers before this altar and lay your woes at the foot of the cross of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I encourage you to do so. And if any who are here now or watching from home wish to join South Haven First United Methodist Church by transfer of membership or by proclamation of faith, I am sure this congregation would be more than happy to have you.
Brother Adam said we are singing Have Thine Own Way, Lord, and we'll sing the first two verses.
Benediction. Father God, as we go forth into this world, sure to encounter troubles and tribulations of our own, we pray that you will give us the knowledge and the wisdom and the strength to remember that we are all beautiful flowers in your garden, that we are cultivated by your hand, and that we are here purely for the enjoyment of you, of your Son, Jesus Christ, and for your most Holy Spirit.